Hello and welcome, viewers. We have Kenneth Andrade, founder and CIO at Old Bridge Capital, who is talking to us in these times of distress. Kenneth, my first question coming to you is, I'm sure I think everyone you've been speaking to, either online or offline, the first question is, how are you dealing with COVID?
How am I dealing with COVID? I mean, this is purely from a financial standpoint. I mean, because you have a situation like this, you're also getting valuations like this, or you're also getting a market like this. Now, it's not very opportune if you've already got a significant part of your money in the market, which most of the participants have. And looking at the depreciation of your portfolio at this point in time, is not the most ideal thing that you would want, right? But, well, so it is. So my sense is that you get events like this and you get situations like this and you also get markets like this and they come across very rarely. So use this as an opportunity more than a risk and probably that's how I'm undertaking the same at this time.
Right. But Kenneth, one question coming to you is, you know, the kind of fall that we've seen that's almost around 35 to 40% from mid-Jan highs. Mm-hmm. Now, if you have to take that into consideration, you have Nifty, which has almost bounced back around 20% from its March lows. And this is pretty much mirroring what the global markets are doing.
Sure.
Now, if you have to go back to 2008 as well, Nifty and markets did actually post four distinct rallies, probably which ranged between almost 12 to 25%. And this was also an overall bear market that we saw in 2008. If you have to take cues from 2008, is this also a word of caution for us in the current, you know, short-term bounce backs and rallies that we're seeing?
Yeah, in the short term, we definitely don't have any answer. So going into December and Jan was a particularly good month for the markets. I don't think anyone envisaged what was to come. Hmm. But it did come, right? So how do we predict short terms? So, which is why the market is fairly evenly divided. I don't think it's evenly divided. I think it's fairly consensus that we will test our new lows before we go up. But no one knows the outcome of what's going to happen either with the pandemic or how corporate India reacts to it all, and how does it move? How does it move forward? I think these are all guessing games that we have, and rather than just try and guess as to where the market's going to move in the next near term, think about it from a 2022 perspective as to what you want to achieve. And if by 2022 the world's going to hit some level of stability, I think life will go on. So use this opportunity. If you are a lot more cautious, hold back some capital, and then probably allocate money. But I really don't think there is a significant space on the downside for the markets to fall.
Okay, so are we saying that we will not see as much pain from here on over the next 3 to 6 months?
As much pain from January to now, I think
yes.
You see the maximum amount of it. Okay. I think that was the biggest part of it all.
Correct.
Let's look at it in a perspective, right? And I won't want to really talk valuations at this point in time, because in the price to earning multiple, the denominator doesn't exist. But hypothetically, if I was to create cash today, say if I got 100 rupees invested and I've got 10 rupees of cash and I wanted to create it to 25 rupees. But if my portfolio is trading at 3x EV EBITDA, okay, and I think it's expensive, okay, what makes it cheap? 2.5x? 2x?
Correct.
I don't have an answer to that. Because I get numbers like this in a situation, in a rare situation, and it's come back. Now, you would be right that the market actually falls off the cliff from here. Only the denominator goes off and remains subdued forever. Okay. And that's where you probably need to push your horizon a little bit into the distance. Will corporate earnings never come back? And if it never comes back, you're right. Okay, then there is a probability that yes, markets could tend lower. But then, but in my career, I very rarely see that happen too many times. I have actually not seen it happen even once.
Right. So, what is the kind of likely dent on the economy as well as the corporate earnings that you're looking at if you have to take the next 18 months into perspective? Because we know the first 6 months of this year are going to be bad, but if you have to look from a year and a half perspective, are you seeing what are the kind of what's the kind of dent expected?
So the first half, if you break up your GDP into 4 quarters, the first half of your GDP, the first half of the year, okay, let's put it as so March, sorry, April, May, June is your first quarter.
Correct.
Turnover of corporates are between 15% to 20% of the full year number. The second half, it is closer to 20. Second quarter is closer to 20%. Okay, so 20% plus 15 to 20%, so between 35 to 40% is what your first half of turnover of corporate India does.
Correct.
Okay, that's where you get impacted. Okay, that's on the headline number. This has a long-term implications on how working capital is managed and how profitability for firms are. And that's the only place that we probably need to plug. How do you plug working capital? And if you can plug working capital and banks and the government is reasonably supportive, I just think you're pushing everything into 2022. That's about it. If India is up and running back in October, November, December, or even November and December, Jan, Feb, March is 40% of India's turnover. Okay, so
Absolutely.
your biggest quarters are not at risk. And that's what you need to be careful about. So even if you're getting locked down into May 3rd, I'd rather have it now than actually having a relapse afterwards.
Correct, correct.
You wouldn't want a relapse in your biggest quarter, right?
Correct.
So wait, I think everything will fall, things will fall into place, and there is a methodology to it, but all of us are experimenting with this process.
So Kenneth, how does someone look at valuations? Do they really make sense currently, or is it best to actually go with your gut feeling for a retail investor, or probably at least with the companies that have on a trajectory basis doing well?
So I'm looking at it in just two formulas. Okay, one is obviously the price to book and replacement cost. So
Okay.
you can work it out either which ways. So when a business actually falls below price to book, or if it costs you 5,000 crores to set up a million ton steel plant, and that steel plant's available at 3,500 crores, obviously you're getting a deal somewhere.
Correct.
So that's one way of actually looking at it, price to book and buying it lower. But the most important part, the other part, which I think is to look at it from a growth perspective. So we are almost certain that profitability is going to dip this year. So take the company's peak profitability. Okay, take a company's peak profitability, and that peak profitability could be as late as the year gone by, which is 2020,
Correct.
and divided it by its existing market capitalization. Now, if your peak profitability by market cap, or market cap by peak, peak profitability by market cap is going to be in low single digit numbers. You basically looking at it from that perspective. So buy it on a cheap price earning multiple, because what you're assuming out here is that particular company or that set of businesses will regain peak profitability.
Okay.
Okay, so if a business is earning 10 rupees today, okay, or last year 10 rupees, and it's going down to 5 rupees, so it's got a
Correct.
50% drop in profit in, and the stock price is trading at 25 times, 25 rupees. Okay, you're essentially buying it at 2.5 times its peak profits.
Correct.
Okay, so that's how I look at the context of valuations in current format. Okay,
Okay.
and market is reflecting everything that will go bad in this year, but they are also extrapolating a lot of things that will happen in the following year and the year after that. I'm a little circumspect of things being as bad as they are today into 2022.
Okay. And Kenneth, with this, what's the kind of sense that you're picking up with your clients, investors? Because what's happening right now is a lot of investments that are moving into gold as an asset class because it's always been a safe haven. What's the sense and what's the mood like looking like for equity as an asset class if you have to compare it to gold or any other asset classes?
So I don't want to have a cross comparison between one asset class versus the other. I think you always have to make your asset allocation call before you start investing. And for me, I've been brought up, I lived all my life into equities, so my asset class is just equities. But gold's had its enormous periods of underperformance, and equities had its enormous periods of outperformance. So when equities actually collapse, I don't find it surprising. Because it always comes back, it always has.
Right. And what's the preference right now? Are people saying that it's better to actually, hold on with the new money, keep it on the sidelines till actually things settle out? Or do you think you will never get such valuations, or probably you will never get these kind of numbers? And probably from a 3 to 5 year perspective, this could be the best time.
I mean, I could go with the latter because I mean, you have to define what is low and then put money to work at that point in time. Now, you might have a different time horizon and you might want to play it a little safe so you can stagger it around the next 2, 3 months. But between the next 2, 3 months and now, my sense is you probably have a little bit of a downside. That's about it. When the question about the upside is not how much will it be there, but when will it come? I think it's just a time horizon which can't be defined. It can never be defined. 2008, nobody knew.
Okay.
2000, nobody knew.
Right. And overall, what's the sense that you're picking up, especially on the back of polarization? What's your view in it? A view on it? Do you think that the availability of credit will drive polarization? And which industries do you look at on that front?
No, we got a little bit of a different twist in how we, or where our preferences are. We are both manufacturing intensive as a portfolio manager. We've got a couple of business into bulk commodities, but most of the bulk commodities find their way into the farm sector, and that's essentially where our preferences are. India's had 3 decades that's gone by. I had to choose one of the three. The one that went by, which is 2011 to 2020, was predominantly a consumer-driven economy. Consumer leverage, so the NBFCs and private sector banks and consumer businesses, which is discretionary spends like cars, automotives, and everything else, those did well. The 2000 to 2010, it was infrastructure, capital spend, lots of debt, lots of credit, nation building, etc. All of that did well. And in the 90s, you had an economy wherein the government balance sheet was weak. You had a depreciation of the currency, and you threw out very large industries like IT. Some kind of engineering, pharmaceuticals, a bit of chemicals, a lot of textiles, etc. So this has been three ways that India's come through. My sense is the next decade is going to be a little different. The next decade has to be one of the three. And in 2019, we essentially took a call of putting money behind government spending or government expanding balance sheet and building the economy through stimulating it through the infrastructure side of the business. While not completely incorrect, that thesis didn't really play out in 2019, but I think we're moderating that to say that we've got a fair chance of being large in a number of industries in the international market. And that's come through because China's vacated the space out there. So the Chinese have vacated some of the larger spaces out there. And India just needs incremental market share to determine large companies. So large companies in India will get created. They'll get created because they have a global opportunity right now amongst a domestic opportunity. And that's how we're moderating our portfolio. That's how we're navigating the portfolio.
Right. But with this as well, what's the sense that you're picking up, especially on the financial space this year? Because right now, with the kind of measures that the RBI is coming out with, do you think that's something which is going to help financials, especially if you have to look at the NBFCs as well? And what's your view on the banking and the NBFC space?
So we don't invest in that. So obviously, I'm very biased when it comes to look at that subset of businesses. But they're the most leveraged part of the economy. So if the economy actually slows off, you have 1 or 2 quarters which are disruptive. The most leveraged part of the economy takes on the chin. Now, any NBFC is leveraged 5 times. Any bank is leveraged nine and 10 times, etc. The other negative part of all of it is that a very large part of the banking system cannot raise incremental capital because a lot of them trade around book or below book. So growth capital is really absent. They can't recapitalize the balance sheets. So I'll wait and watch. There will be a couple of businesses that will come through which will be very strong from now on.
Right. And overall, again, there has been constant underperformance from the broader markets as well. What would you advise an investor, Kenneth, at this point in time to do, especially with the mid caps and the small caps?
So I've spent my entire career tracking mid caps and investing in them, and the last 2 years haven't been the great in my career. But the more I look at them, the more I'm convinced that that part of the world is offers a lot of value. It also offers a reasonable amount of growth, and there are some companies that are part of the business. So take your time, be picky. Everything's available at a nice price. You just have to choose where you want to be and how you want to be. If I get it a little like a little dartboard, you have probability right and wrong in probably 10 companies that you pick. So the risks are very low on going wrong there. Okay, you might suffer. You might encounter a lot of volatility, but that normally goes with the entire process. If you want outsized returns, you have to take that outsized volatility also.
Okay, so right now, if you have to look at, you know, large cap versus the mid cap space, take valuations as per the formula that you are using, where would your bets be?
So large cap versus mid cap. So I really don't look at it that way. India, a lot of India's largest metal businesses are now mid cap sizes, right? A lot of India's large automotive businesses are now mid caps, and a lot of auto ancillaries, which are large caps, are now like mid caps or like micro caps. I think that oscillates between large and mid. You've got to buy a good company. So wherever in that basket it actually comes from, you've got to go out and buy it. Today, you've got the luxury of picking a sector or a business and buying the largest company in that industry. So hypothetically, if you want to make a portfolio of 10 businesses, 10 stocks, list the 10 industries you want to buy, okay, and buy the best company in each of those industries. Okay,
Okay.
you can make it as simple. You can dumb down portfolio management as simply as that. So if you have to do one company per industry, obviously it limits you to just one company, one bank.
Okay.
Okay, it limits you to just one FMCG business. It limits you to just one automotive company, right? But you've got to choose whether you want the best company or you want the fastest growing company. And like I said, today it gives you the luxury to buy things at the way you want, at a value, at a price that you haven't seen for some time.
Right. And overall, Kenneth, very lastly, in terms of the March mutual fund data that is out as well, clearly, if you see, in spite of the markets getting into a tailspin, you have seen the benchmark indices crash in line with global market trends in the month of March. Mutual fund investors have not actually, you know, pressed the panic button. Any reason that you're picking up for that on that front?
I mean, it's a nice trend to see. I hope it sticks. That's all I can say. But I haven't got any trend data on this.
Do you think it will continue?
I hope it really does. It's good for the underlying investor because you don't want a poor experience when investing in equities, right? And especially at the bottom end of the cycle, this is a time where you should accelerate investments into the asset class.
Right. And again, on the mutual fund side as well, where is the money flowing? Again, is it mainly on the equity side? And if equity, if you have to look at equity as well, what are the kind of funds where you're seeing money flowing into?
Hiral, I haven't been tracking most of the MF data right now. I do keep a track of how much money is coming into the cycle, but in which category, how it is going, I don't have that. I don't track that.
Right. And very lastly, Kenneth, your final view for the investors and I mean the retail investors, especially who've been struggling right now.
Good times come and good times are always followed by bad times. Okay. And these are not really bad times. This, you have to use this as an opportunity to relook at your portfolio and just stay committed to the asset class. We've seen multiple cycles. I think people have warned about booms and busts. Okay. Busts don't remain forever and you don't have a good cycle that doesn't remain forever. So both ends, we see extremes at both ends. So I just say stay in there. It's a matter of time. It's only a matter of time. It will come back.
Right. So it's a matter of time. It will come back. Thank you, Kenneth. Thank you for joining us on the show. And we will come back to you as well to get more opinions after a month or two as to where to go in from here on. Thank you for joining in.
Thank you very much.